approach to social programs.
And at a hearing this morning, Congressman Moffitt will level the charge that by pulling away this particular social safety net, the Reagan administration is not aware that a good program is falling through it. Bettina Gregory, ABC News, Capitol Hill.
In other news this morning, new car sales by American automakers dropped 8.3% in mid-June as consumers continued to resist high prices. The ailing Chrysler Corporation was the only company to up sales by 16%. A new government report says the median cost of a single-family home nearly doubled between 1973 and 1979, while family income rose only 59%. Rents also grew faster than income, with an average increase of 66%. Two small planes collided over a Los Angeles shopping center last night, sending one plane crashing through the roof of a crowded department store. The pilot, a drug that prevents premature labor, was responsible for the birth of healthy. Each time she was given the newly approved drug, Ritodrine, to stop the labor and to allow her babies to reach full term. That's our news for this hour. John?
Thank you, Steve. It's 34 minutes after the hour. We'll have John Coleman on the weather after this from General Mills Granola Bars.
American Express presents...
Hello. I want to fly to San Francisco.
Okay.
Then Miami. Then San Diego, Houston, Jacksonville, Las Vegas,
Detroit, Sarasota.
Say hello to Pan Am, because...
Original and new green pepper. Talk about taste.
It's 7:36. That's time for the weather with John Coleman. What you got?
Well, I just want to tell you, if you're planning to eat at a sidewalk cafe today, Joan, be careful there in New York. Big storms headed your way. Hello, everybody. The weather report sponsored by Geritol. We're in tune with space as usual, and these are the pictures that have come back since yesterday mid-morning. You can watch the sequence and see the big storms build up and sweep from Kansas through Missouri, Iowa, Illinois, Indiana into Ohio. Meanwhile, it was hitting 104 out at Elko, Nevada. That's the hottest they have ever been. And at dawn this morning, the big storms are moving into the northeast, and we're advising that area to pay attention. On the radar at Atlantic City, a big storm just off the coast there of New Jersey. Another pretty good thunderstorm at Farmingdale out on Long Island. A little rain falling up as far as New Haven. Big thunderstorm has come across the Zanesville, Ohio area and is headed into Wheeling, Parkersburg, south of Pittsburgh. Pretty good thunderstorm through the Cleveland area, overheaded toward Buffalo, New York. It's gusty there. Big flooding thunderstorms have just moved south of the Kansas City area and are now in western portion of Missouri. It's thunderstorming at Columbia and Jefferson City. There are a few thunder showers on the radar out in the valley of Northern California. How about that? And those will be spreading out today. The rain won't amount to much, but anything that falls will be welcome out in Northern California, Northern Nevada, southeastern portion of Oregon, Southern Idaho, and Northern Utah by evening. A few other thunder showers in eastern New Mexico and also in the eastern portion of Arizona. But the big storms will be in the Northeast. From West Virginia, Virginia, Maryland, Delaware, Pennsylvania, northward through New York, Massachusetts, Connecticut, Rhode Island, into Vermont and New Hampshire. Look at the heat in the West. The 90-degree readings will be pushing up into interior portions of Oregon, Washington, and a good part of Idaho today. I'm predicting 94 at Twin Falls and 94 also at Reno today, 113 at Lost Wages, while it's 85 in stormy Boston and New York and in Cincinnati. In beautiful air, it'll hit 80 today in Detroit. That's the national weather. Now, the local forecast.
In Chicago, enjoy a nice day. Mostly sunny, breezy and mild, a high near 80. Tonight, fair, a low in the 50s. Tomorrow, sunny and pleasant, a high in the 70s. The temperatures now, Lakefront 67, O'Hare 67.
This time of year when the humidity can really hit you, but that's a relative thing, and we'll talk about it in half an hour and half a minute. Back to New York. Later this half hour, a Good Morning America, Joan Lunden interviews actor Richard Mulligan.
Now's the time to get yourself Geritol.
Geritol. I used to think I was too young for Geritol. Well, I'm not. And neither are you.
Now's the time to get yourself Geritol.
I start every morning with the Geritol tablet, so I'm sure I'm getting enough iron and the important vitamins I need.
Geritol, America's number one iron and vitamin supplement. Don't wait for someday. Geritol is for now.
Now's the time to get yourself
Geritol.
And take it every day.
It's 7:39. Well, while all the young stars battle it out to see who'll be number one at Wimbledon this year, we decided to find out what some of the past champions are up to. like Rod Laver, who's won that prestigious tennis tournament four times. He told us here at Good Morning America, I've got fond memories of my career there, but I'm now in the minor circuits with my 12-year-old son. Rod has been playing the series of Legends tournaments as well for men over 35. He also endorses equipment and clothes. He runs a tennis resort and he plays tennis all the time. He says it occupies his whole life. And also last year's women's champ, Evonne Goolagong, she's just as single-minded, but not about tennis. Right now, she's more interested in her new son, Morgan. And when the women's final is being played this year, Evonne, her husband Roger Colley, and their 4-year-old daughter Kelly will be celebrating Morgan's 5-week birthday at Hilton Head, South Carolina, where they live. And also, former Wimbledon champ Jack Kramer has no regrets about not playing there anymore. His autograph racket is one of the biggest sellers of all times, and it's helped make Jack a very wealthy man. Jack, who is known as the czar within the tennis world, still loves the sport, but when not on the court, he's on the course. The golf course, that is, his very own in Los Angeles. And we'll leave now Wimbledon, England, and travel to Hollywood for Ruth Batchelor's report. Good morning, Ruth.
Good morning, Joan, and good morning, America. Round one. In this corner, Julie Andrews and her filmmaker husband, Blake Edwards. In this corner, Paramount. The fight is over Blake's new film, SOB, which ironically satirizes, for one thing, overspending in Hollywood. Here are both sides. Blake says Julie and co-stars William Holden, Larry Hagman, and Shelley Winters are angry at Paramount because they refuse to pay for a very expensive press junket. They feel the film needs heavy promotion in such a competitive market. From Paramount's corner, they say they can't afford Blake's excessive spending. So Blake will spring for $200,000 out of his own pocket. And the only people who will enjoy the fracas are the press and the people who see the movie. And old rumors of MASH going off the air are heating up again. Alan Alda, according to insiders, is so busy with his movie making that he doesn't have much time left over for Hawkeye. Other cast members have told the producers if the show can't maintain its number one spot, they would like to leave. At the moment, there are 4 shows in the can for next season, and following the strike, the cast will be working to fulfill their contracts. But it looks like next season, a TV classic may well be honorably discharged. And there are those who would have us believe a big Hollywood star will play the lead role of a deaf-mute in the movie version of the Pulitzer Prize-winning play, Children of a Lesser God. The producer wants a real deaf actress for the role, which won Phyllis Frelick, who is deaf, a Tony Award. Frelick is not, however, a box office name, and Jane Fonda and Meryl Streep have been mentioned. Dollars may yet win out over reality. Remember, Jane Wyman won the Oscar as the deaf-mute in Johnny Belinda, and she's still talking her head off. We'll keep you posted. And 69-year-old Oscar-winning songwriter Sammy Kahn was given a star-studded birthday party at La Cage Folle. The sprightly lyricist, who's just become legally divorced, told friends, "I wanted to get my name back, but she wouldn't give it to me." The man who wrote 3 Coins in the Fountain said, "I may not be Paul McCartney, but I don't want people dating Mrs. Kahn when she no longer is. Maybe love will be lovelier the third time around, Sammy." I'm Ruth Batchelor in Hollywood. John?
Thank you, Ruth. It's 7:43. Recently, Joan learned about the difference between a brand name, a household word, and a trademark, and found out how the trademark protects us when we buy things.
In packages and advertising, we are used to seeing certain name brands and logos, and many of those names and designs are protected by the law, and Professor Arthur Miller of the Harvard Law School is with us this morning to explain how that happens. Good morning.
Good morning.
How does the law protect people, both the consumer and the businesses themselves?
By trademark. It's, in effect, a monopoly on a name or a slogan or a design. And its purpose is to protect us so that when we go to a store and we look at the yellow box with the name Kodak on it, we know we're getting Kodak film. And Kodak is sure that nobody else is using a cheap imitation, so it protects their goodwill.
Now, can all name brands be trademarked?
You need a certain amount of distinctiveness before the law will give you the right to put that little R underneath the name. You won't get dog food trademarked for dog food or a sure fit for furniture covers. It's got to be distinctive. A perfect illustration is the world's most famous trademark, Coca-Cola. The word cola is called generic. It describes the drink.
Okay.
So the only thing that's protected is Coke or Coca. So it's the fanciful, the Xerox, the Kodak, not descriptive words like gold medal or champion. Yeah.
Now, once you get that trademark, does that last forever?
It can if it's not challenged, and indeed, corporations pay an enormous amount of money to get their trademarks early, sometimes even before the product exists. There's this marvelous story, I don't know whether it's true, that the tobacco companies already have trademarks for the names for marijuana cigarettes. Sometimes the product is a victim of its own success. Aspirin. That used to be a trademark, but because everybody starts calling that little pill aspirin, it becomes a word and it's taken out of protection.
So then it's like cellophane. Fair game then.
That's right. That's right. Again, the corporations pay a great deal of money to protect those names. They engage in proper use advertising. People like Sunkist and Coca-Cola and Xerox and Formica are always telling us that, no, we do not Xerox, we photocopy. Xerox is a trademark. That's designed to make sure that Xerox doesn't become a word and they can maintain their monopoly.
What happens if somebody else uses somebody else's trademark?
Let me give you an illustration. What do you think this is, Joan?
That's a Rolls-Royce, whatever.
That's exactly what Rolls-Royce was afraid you'd say. This is customized kit for Chevrolet Monte Carlos. And Rolls-Royce brought an infringement action, and the court concluded that the flying lady hood ornament infringed, that the CC rather than RR infringed, that the design of the grill and the use of the name Custom Cloud was too close to Silver Cloud, and they issued an injunction against the infringement.
I can see why. It's using something else someone else worked so hard on.
Parasites.
Yeah, you're right. Thanks for coming in today.
A pleasure, Joan.
We'll be right back.
Do you know how to choose the right soap for your face? Start with one that's for your face, not everybody's. Like Neutrogena. Neutrogena offers a specific formula for your skin type. And it's so pure, you can see through it. It cleanses so mildly, it's recommended even for sensitive skin. But don't just take my word for it. Ask a dermatologist about Neutrogena.
Hey, Jenny, does your mouthwash work as long as Listerine?
Mine works just as long. Well, almost as long. Long enough?
Use Listerine, Listerine Strong.
Works hours longer than your number two mouthwash.
And Listerine Antiseptic kills germs that can cause bad breath.
I'm in style now.
For clean breath hours longer, should you ever be without Listerine?
The first marathon, 26 miles, 385 yards. It took incredible endurance, incredible spirit. We at Marathon Oil remember that spirit. The spirit that constantly pushes our company further to pursue excellence in everything that carries our name. Marathon Oil. The spirit to excel. To go farther. Marathon. The long distance gasoline.
Whenever the sun shines, you should remember that overexposure may lead to premature aging of the skin and skin cancer. The liberal and regular use over the years of PABA Plus may help reduce the chance of these harmful effects. PABA Plus, the moisturizer that also screens the sun, helps your skin feel softer, look younger every day. PABA Plus.
Richard Mulligan has been an actor for 22 years, growing from, well, professionally humble beginnings on a stage of a small theater in Miami to parts on Broadway to the very memorable role of that bungling Bert on the TV series Soap. And now you can see him in a leading role in the new Blake Edwards movie, SOB, and Richard Mulligan is here with us this morning. Good morning.
Good morning to you and good morning, America.
You know, I heard something about you. I heard that originally you really didn't want to be an actor at all. You wanted to be a playwright, the guy struggling behind the typewriter and not out there in front of the audience. What happened?
I was in Miami and I got lost and I had a flat tire. And the flat tire was right in front of a gas station, so I thought, well, it's not bad, but so I pulled it over. And while they were fixing the tire, I looked up across the street and there was a theater called Studio M. which I'd heard about in New York. So I had a play in the car. I had two one-act plays and half of a three-act play. So I thought maybe Providence is talking to me. So I crossed the street, went into the theater with the play, and they were very busy. And they said, come back at 8 o'clock tonight. It's tonight at 8. And I found out what it was. They were auditioning for Beyond the Horizon, O'Neill's Beyond the Horizon. And the stage manager said, you'd be great for Andy Mayo. I left, got in the car, they never saw the play, and I was driving now trying to find my parents' home in Miami at the time. And I thought, well, if I'm going to write for actors, maybe I should know what they go through. So I went to the audition to find out what it is for an act to be an actor. And I hated it. You know, it was awful. It was terrible doing
an
audition.
Did you really hate it, or did you hate it and love it?
No, I just didn't like it. I didn't like it at all. And the next day they called me and gave me the part. Then I thought, well, and I was still trying to serve the writing. I thought, well, I'll do the play and let's see what an actor does in a play. And we got rave reviews. And I thought, well, maybe I belong here. Nobody's producing my plays. And I moved over to acting.
Once again, maybe Providence.
And came back to New York and studied and went hungry and all that stuff. But it was really to serve a writing career that I became an actor.
Are you glad you made that decision?
Yes.
You've enjoyed acting.
I've enjoyed it. There was a time, I suppose, when I did. I remember very clearly thinking that it was the worst choice I ever made in my life. You know, I had been busted and broke and sleeping in bus stations and doing plays in strange little theaters and all. And I began to sort of feel sorry for myself and lament and all that kind of stuff. And then I realized that over the years as an actor, I had made great, fast friends who have become my counselors now in my own personal life.
They're very important to you, aren't they?
And it came through acting. You say, I met them through the theater and through acting. And I stopped then complaining about being an actor.
Do you want to still be a playwright?
There's something
deep down inside.
Yeah, I enjoy working with writers, which is what I do now, is people send me stuff and we read and we talk about it and I work with writers. Someday, perhaps.
I know that playing Bert on soap was a grueling schedule, really kept you busy. Now it's been canceled.
Mm-hmm.
What are your feelings now? What does that mean to a career like yours when it's canceled?
I'm not sure what it means to the career. I know that for me, I'm going to miss Bert. I will miss him. I'm very fond of him. And of the actors I worked with, especially Catherine Damon and Billy Crystal and Teddy Wass, we're very close to each other. And I will miss being with them. But after 20-some-odd years of acting, everything closes. Every play closes, every movie's over, everything is over, so it's over. And I've said goodbye to it with affection.
Well, we know that now that you have a new movie,
and
it's kind of about the life at the top in Hollywood. You play a big-time producer of a big flop. What kind of a character is this guy?
Felix, former in SOB. Felix has been up to the point of the beginning of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Successful at all times, producer, everything was a hit. And the movie begins with the information that his most current production, which cost $30 million, is a disaster. It is a bomb. The critics have absolutely spat upon him. They really hate it. And it's what happens when in Hollywood or Iowa, any big business, when a very expensive project fails.
Everyone's trying
now to fix it.
We do have a scene, and it's right as you're screening the movie for some of the other people who have worked on it. So let's take a look at that.
Okay.
All the day.
I broke you and I can make you. It's rotten, but it's a revelation. We keep the basics set, Rich. It's still a dream, but now a fruity nightmare of erotic symbolism. Seduced in a nursery, but not voluntarily. Not the victim of her own insatiable lust, as she always feared, but the victim of a powerful aphrodisiac slipped in her basto. New lyrics bar, prurient but profound.
Felix, it's not that easy.
Gino, new choreography. The animals are out. Somehow, I don't think bestiality makes it musically.
But Felix, it's such a different concept.
A different concept for a different world. Gino, costumes. Agnes, come on. Agnes, what about the costumes?
Well, it depends. I mean, how erotic do you really want to go?
Go, go, E-R-O-T-I-C, go, go, go!
Oh,
Sally Miles, America's G-rated darling in the B-U-F-F.
Why not?
Oh, Felix, darling, some of her fans still don't think she goes to the bathroom.
Now, we should say, too, that the woman that's in the movie is your wife in the movie, and it's played by Julie Andrews.
Oh, yeah, and she's so splendid.
I hope it was a lot more fun making the movie. It had nothing to do with what we see there.
Yeah, the making of SOB has been, for me, the most warm and comfortable place to work, and it's the first time I ever felt any real affection for filmmaking. I never had that before. I've done films, Little Big Man and General Custer, and I enjoyed doing them, but this is the first time I felt warm towards it, and it had to do with Blake Edwards and Julie and Bill Holder and Bob Preston. It was a great company to be in. And Julie, only Julie could pull this off because of who she is to the world and who she is. And she just sends herself up so well.
Well, we're all going to look forward to seeing it. SOB with Richard Mulligan. Thank you. It's been nice meeting you.
It's been my pleasure.
We're going to be back in just a moment. Stay with us.
Who do you know in real estate that can help you find the money to buy your first home?
ERA.
Who has a system to tell you in a single day if you're likely to qualify for the house you want?
ERA.
Who knows 38 ways to finance a home and which one's best for you?
ERA.
When you're ready to buy, call your ERA real estate specialist. We know where the money is. That's another reason we're selling houses.
Anna Maria Albergetti.
Sue, it's been years.
Still use Good Seasons Italian.
Not exactly.
He means I use new improved Good Seasons.
What's so new?
An improved delizioso taste. And look, just minutes after pouring, compare Good Seasons to the leading bottle Italian.
The bottle's separated,
but the herbs and spices in Good Seasons stay mixed longer to stay...
delicious. Delizioso.
New improved Good Seasons stays mixed to stay delicious.
I've got a confession to make. I've always loved the freshness of Tic Tac. But when Sugar Freeze came along, I figured I'd give up some of that freshness to get fewer calories. Know what? I was wrong. Sugar-free Velamints have 9 calories each, and Tic Tac has 1.5. Not 9, 1.5. So I'm staying with Tic Tac, because to get fewer calories, I don't have to give up taste or freshness or nothing. Tic Tac, the 1.5 calorie mint.
Hurry up and follow me, for soon I will be gone.
You think you've seen Peter Pan? You haven't. Not like this. It's no wonder all Chicago loves Peter Pan. The Tribune raved, Sandy Duncan sails to glory. Bless her high-flying soul, she is something to see. The Sun-Times cheered, Sandy Duncan is irresistible as Peter Pan. Don't miss it. You'll leave the theater flying. Order your tickets now. For phone reservations, call 791-6000. That's 791-6000.
In this hour, we'll meet some of Hollywood's top stuntmen.
And in our next half hour today, Eleanor Smeal, the National Organization for Women, she's going to tell us about the new campaign to pass the Equal Rights Amendments before it's too late. So stay with us.
If you're leaving us now in this hour, well, you go out and have a terrific day.
Good Morning America is the number one early news and information program in the country.
Tonight, when crime pays, give a killer money and protection and he'll be your witness. Maybe he'll tell the truth.
You're so tempted and anxious to get Mr. Big that you'll believe and pay for almost anything.
Are paid witnesses worth the price? Watch an ABC News close-up tonight.
Most commercials, the cars start up here with some help from a helicopter. But these babies from Subaru don't need help. They can switch from front to four-wheel drive. And for tougher going, they keep going with a dual-range gearbox. Any cars would look good up here. But all Subaru four-wheel drive cars even look good getting up here.
Save on a new 1981 Subaru wagon today at your Chicagoland Subaru dealers.
Isn't it wonderful to know there's finally a magazine that tells you about everything that's really important to you every week? It's Woman's World, the first weekly magazine for women. This week, Woman's World tells you how to keep your energy up with juices, exercise, and more. How to make your own fashion fireworks. How pretty florals and a little glitter can give you a romantic look.
Woman's World. It's new every week. Only 75 cents at checkout counters. If you miss a week, you miss a lot.
Brand name quality furniture at factory cost prices you buy just like a dealer at Weekend Warehouse Clearance Center, 2750 West 35th Street, Chicago. Give to the Hadley School for the Blind.
I'm Ross John from Langley, Kentucky, in the Southern Appalachian Mountains. Good morning, America.
Good morning. It's Thursday, the 25th of June. David Hartman is off. I'm John Forsythe. I'm the new boy on the block this week. And, of course, I'm with Joan Lunden. Good morning, Joan.
Good morning.
Supporters of the Equal Rights Amendment are gearing up for what they call their countdown. Because if the ERA is not ratified in just 1 year, it's going to be dead, at least for this round. Now, in a few minutes, we'll talk with Eleanor Smeal, the president of the National Organization for Women, about that countdown campaign.
We are also going to find out why so many people love to watch soap operas. And we'll talk with Melody Thomas of The Young and the Restless. She plays Nikki Reed on that show. Then we'll visit a town where the people are literally afraid to drink the water. And we'll also meet some people who are really being hurt by the baseball strike. A lot of strikes lately. Will Dynasty be affected by the strike out in Hollywood?
I'm afraid the whole of the television schedule is going to be a little delayed this year. But it's 1 minute after eight, and Steve Bell has the news down in Washington. Good morning, Steve.
Morning, John. Good morning, everyone. After weeks of bobbing and weaving, the Reagan administration and House Democrats are finally coming to blows over budget cuts. Republicans are gearing up for a House fight today over a Rules Committee decision blocking a simple yes or no vote on Mr. Reagan's proposed cuts in social programs. And Mr. Reagan's calling that Rules Committee decision sabotage and political gimmickry aimed at derailing his economic plan. The president's on the road selling his program and slamming his opponents. Susan King reports.
Today's speech to the California Taxpayers Association will stress the same issues the president outlined yesterday. White House strategy is keep the budget battle simple, a fight with the president on one side and the democratically controlled Congress on the other.
Although the issues in the latest budget battle are complicated, White House officials are making it a battle featuring good guys and bad guys. Before the national JCs, the president, of course, was a good guy with the economic answer.
To those who say we can't cut spending, lower tax rates, reduce inflation, and yes, rebuild the defenses we need in this dangerous world, I have a six-word answer. Yes, we can, and yes, we must.
And the bad guys were the Democrats who are holding up the president's program in the House.
It's a sad commentary on the state of our opposition when they have to resort to a parliamentary gimmick to thwart the will of the people.
Current polls show the president's popularity slipping, but a traveling president can excite the public. For security reasons, the public was not permitted to greet the president when he arrived back home in Los Angeles, the first time since his inauguration. But this trip is designed to prove, despite the polls, presidential grassroots popularity is strong. The White House hopes, in a fight pitting Congress against Mr. Reagan, the president will win. Susan King, ABC News, with the president in Los Angeles.
In overnight news, the FBI is reducing the number of agents investigating the murders of black youths in Atlanta. Meanwhile, Associated Press reports that Wayne Williams could be linked to as many as 16 of the Atlanta killings. Presently, Williams charged only with the last of the 28 murders. For the first time in months, all the country's coal mines will be operating normally today. Mine construction workers are returning to work today after ratifying a new contract. The construction workers have been off the job for 90 days. Vice President George Bush is in London after his visit with French President François Mitterrand. Bush voiced concern in France about the four communists named to cabinet posts, but Mitterrand said the communists will be sealed off from defense secrets and important decision-making. And an American ballerina won a first prize this morning in the prestigious Moscow International Ballet Competition. Anne Garrels has that story.
It was for her interpretation of this Russian classic, The Blue Bird from Sleeping Beauty, that Amanda Macaro was awarded a gold medal. She's the first American ever to win top honors at the prestigious Moscow Ballet Competition. The 17-year-old ballerina from Washington, D.C., hoped she might win a medal here in Moscow, but she says she never dared think about the gold one. A Amanda was too exhausted to wait at the Bolshoi Theater for the results, which didn't come through until 3 this morning, but her teacher called her at the hotel with the good news. Honey, she said, we hit the jackpot. Anne Gerrold, ABC News, Moscow.
In other news, the White House says it's not giving up its battle to win approval for the sale of AWACS radar planes to Saudi Arabia. A spokesman says the administration's confident Congress will approve the sale, even though a majority of members of both houses are on record now against the AWACS deal. A federal judge is temporarily blocking Major League Baseball owners from collecting strike insurance from Lloyd's of London. The judge's ruling came in a suit by umpires who charge the owners have not tried in good faith to settle the baseball players' strike. And with a year to go before time runs out for the ratification of the Equal Rights Amendment, ERA's supporters have started a last-ditch campaign for ratification. But opponents are just as fervent, as Bob Clark reports in the fourth part of our week-long series on the ERA.
The Equal Rights Amendment has been opposed over the years with a passion matching that of its most ardent supporters. The Stop ERA movement turned into a potent political force with its warnings that the constitutional amendment would destroy the American family, push women into a man's world, even draft them into the army. The battle seemed touch and go until Ronald Reagan, who, like many conservative males, opposed ERA, began pulling ahead last year in the contest for the Republican presidential nomination. The Republican convention danced around the ERA issue, professing its support of women's rights as long as they didn't lose their traditional rights, like exemption from the military draft. With Jimmy Carter supporting ERA, Reagan's opposition was becoming a political hazard, and he sought to reassure women voters.
I cannot permit this campaign to go forward while some people apparently believe that I would in any way restrict the freedom and rights of women.
It was at this press conference that Reagan announced he would name a woman to the Supreme Court. Foes of ERA say women are winning their battle for job rights without a constitutional amendment. The question of drafting women is expected to be decided in the next 10 days by the Supreme Court. But the Equal Rights Amendment isn't likely to become part of the Constitution as long as an unrelenting opponent, Ronald Reagan, remains in the White House. Bob Clark, ABC News, Washington.
And as John said, in a few minutes, we'll be talking with the president of the National Organization for Women, Ellie Schmiel, about a new ERA campaign. Finally, Commerce Secretary Malcolm Baldrige is proud of his rodeo background and his ability to lasso steers. But he says that a gossip column report he lassos his secretary at the end of each workday just isn't true. On the other hand, Baldrige admits he did lasso her once with the rope he keeps on the saddle that sits in his office, but that was because she asked how it was done. Now she knows. John?
Thank you, Steve. 7 minutes after eight, and it's time for the weather with John Coleman out in the land of the Chicago Cubbies. Good morning, John.
Hey, the Cubs may play baseball again someday.
Well, I hope it's soon. All of us hope it's soon.
Well, it wouldn't be just because the strike is over. They'd have to get some new players and stuff. They really want to play baseball. Never mind. Hey, folks, let's look at the weather map this morning. What do I see here? I see some very big thunderstorms producing flooding in Linn County, Kansas, and over into Cass, Bates, and Henry County in Missouri. Those are the biggest in the country. But there are other big thunderstorms in Ohio moving into western Pennsylvania and northern West Virginia. Thundershowers on the New Jersey and Long Island coastline are diminishing for the moment. All summertime, good old glass of water, that's the thing to relieve you. But if you turn that into a gas, put it in the air, it becomes humidity. And if the air is cool, that glass of water produces a very high humidity. But as you warm up, the relative humidity drops. Like at dawn this morning, a large part of the country is over 80% humidity, but no part of the country will be over that this afternoon. But there will be areas over 50%, and with those high temperatures, that's uncomfy. That's the national weather. Now, the local forecast.
In Chicago, a beauty. Mostly sunny, breezy and mild, a high near 80. Tonight, fair, low in the 50s. Tomorrow, sunny and pleasant, a high in the 70s. The temperature's now lakefront 68, O'Hare 70 degrees.
Radar pictures, satellite, all of that stuff when I return in half an hour. Now it's back to John in New York.
Thank you, John. It's 8 minutes after eight. Now, we hear about the players and the owners who are hurt by the baseball strike, but there are many, many others who make their living at baseball, too. Now, three people who are being hurt by the strike are with us today. Nancy Faust, Dennis Cashin, and George Whitfield. Good morning.
Good morning.
Now, Nancy, you play the organ out at the ballpark for the Chicago White Sox, don't you?
That's correct, John.
Now, You're unemployed at the moment, and I understand that your husband is not working. Now, what are you doing in this situation? How badly is the strike hurting you?
Well, we're keeping in tune, of course, with the news, and we've been very encouraged by today's news. Just the fact that they're meeting makes us think that somebody's coming up with something, and perhaps the players and the owners will get their act together. And we're just very confident that something's going to gel pretty soon.
Well, if this strike goes on for any length of time, what are you going to do?
Well, it would hurt us, and we'd probably have to, I'd have to look to other means to play
like
the organ somewhere. Oh, perhaps some steady place, or at a dinners, more often for dinners
doesn't
around
like
the Chicago area.
No Billy Martin, no Reggie Jackson?
No, that wouldn't be much fun. This has been my lifestyle for 12 years now at the ballpark.
What do you miss out at the ballpark, not being there?
Well, I do miss the interaction with the people, because my situation at the ballpark is unique, because the organ is located out in the stands with the people. And it's become a part of my life, just to see them and see the game.
I understand that you play very well, too.
Oh, thank you.
Dennis, you're a bat boy for the Baltimore Orioles, aren't you?
Yes.
And haven't you had three of your brothers bat boys before you?
Yes.
Kind of a family tradition there.
Yes, we've been in baseball for a long time.
Ah, tell me, you made $1,400 last year as a bat boy.
Yes.
What'd you use that money for?
Well, I'm keeping it in the bank because next year I'll be a senior and I'm saving up for college. I'd like to go away. I want to help with to put myself through college.
Well, are you able to take another job during this strike?
Well, I don't really want to take a job, because if the strike is over, I don't want to, like, quit the job, so I might not be able to fulfill the job, you know, once the strike continues, because I'd really like to go back to baseball. So I was thinking about if the strike, you know, holds out for a long length of time, that I get a job during school next year.
Of course, Earl Weaver needs all the enthusiasm he can get around that ballpark, doesn't he?
Yes.
George, you've been a vendor. You've been selling scorecards and things out at the various stadiums, mostly the Yankee Stadium, the last 47 years selling. That's a long time.
Polo Grounds, Yankee Stadium, and Shea Stadium.
How badly is the strike hurting you?
Very, very bad.
In what sense?
In every way, because that's my livelihood. And I'm attached to this to the ballparks, and it takes a lot out of you.
Indeed it does.
At the present time, I have a family to take care of, and this thing should be over. I hope so.
You and your wife also have a stand
outside
Yankee Stadium.
I have a souvenir business, adjunct to the Yankee Stadium.
Nobody's buying that stuff now, is it?
Not now.
How long can you hold out?
I can't hold out any longer.
That's tough,
isn't it? I just wish it'd be over tomorrow.
Now, tell me, if you could be at the bargaining table with the ball players and with the owners, what would you tell them? What would you tell them, George?
I'd tell them both get together and let's get this thing over with.
In a hurry, huh?
In a hurry. There's over 600,000 people out of work throughout the both leagues. I mean, American and National League. So you can understand what we're up against.
Absolutely. What about you, Dennis? What would you tell them?
I'd tell them to sit down and stay until they compromise. Seems like all they do is they have so-called meetings, and then they skip a few weeks and have a so-called meeting. I just make them stay there until they did compromise, because I think eventually they would, each would get their fair share, but they would be satisfied. But if they would just stay and compromise for as long as it takes, because it's very important and it's hurting a lot of people.
I would think so. Nancy, how about you?
Well, I'd want to make sure that they consider what this must be doing to the fans and how they may be losing a lot of faith in the game. And what a void the fans must be feeling right now, just not to have a national pastime to enjoy. It's
Absolutely.
A real void in our life.
Of course, it really is, because there's so much pride in each people in their own cities take in their ball teams and the like. And there's so much of emotional release, I would think, too, rooting for a team when you've been working hard all day at your job.
Boy, we all need that relaxation a couple hours a day, and it's really good therapy, I think, for the public.
Very nice to have had you. Here they are, the unsung heroes of the ballpark. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll hear about the new campaign to pass the Equal Rights Amendment with just 1 year to go after this.
And now, Marshall Fields presents What's Cooking.
Believe
it or not, every once in a while, I get a chance to sit back and relax and take the sun. But I don't take too much of it, because too much sun is really kind of bad for you. brings out the wrinkles in your skin, and it makes it age more than it would normally. So I'm going to stay away from it too much, and I think you should too. There are a lot of commercial sun blocks and sunscreens and tanning aids that can help, but I wonder if you knew there were some foods that can help too. If you take a freshly sliced cucumber and press out the juice from that cucumber on your skin, not only will it cool you down, but it will help prevent sunburn. Another thing that will help prevent sunburn is a little bit of sesame oil. It's a wonderful sunblock. It holds out the ultraviolet light, and you can put it all over your body and block out that ultraviolet light, and it'll help give you a nice tan. If you've been out in the sun too long and you've turned yourself into a nice lobster red and you like to bleach out that red, what you might try is a mixture of a little lemon juice and some plain yogurt. It's a moisturizer and a bleach, and it does a wonderful job. I can't figure out why I suddenly have an overwhelming desire to get into a salad bowl. That's what's cooking. I'm Bert Wolf.
Now at Marshall Fields, you'll find dramatic savings on fine bone china from Minton and Royal Doulton. Save 20% on four-piece place settings. You'll find a vast array of beautiful patterns to choose from, each with distinctive Royal Doulton edgings. Save, too, on a variety of place setting and serving pieces. Now's the perfect time to start or replenish your service to choose special gifts for the bride-to-be. Save 20% on fine bone china from Royal Doulton and Minton. On sale now at Marshall Fields.
After 8, June 30th, 1982, that marks the deadline for ratification of the Equal Rights Amendment. Now, that means there's 1 year left, that's all, for the ERA to be approved in three more states. In a few hours, the National Organization for Women is launching its ERA countdown campaign, and Eleanor Smeal, the president of NOW, will be addressing the National Press Club in Washington to outline the organization's strategy for the coming year. Ellie Smeal is with us this morning in our Washington studio. Good morning.
Good morning.
You know, a lot of people feel that there's been such a shift to the right since Reagan took office. I wonder how you feel this shift to the right has affected your push with the ERA.
Well, actually, it's helping to fuel it, because reality is that there's a backlash. There's a backlash to the anti-woman proposals. You know, for the last 15 years, we've been trying to say that a hostile administration and a hostile Congress to women's rights could repeal the statutes or make us go backwards. And many people never believed that. Today, more people believe that than ever before. And they realize that the statutes that we have can easily be reversed. And in fact, in many cases, that's what's happening.
So how do you fight all of this? What is your strategy going to be in the coming year?
The strategy in the coming year is that we are going to absolutely remind people constantly of the time. We're 12 months left. I'm wearing a countdown button. People have a feeling that this can go on and on. But the reality of it is that if we do not ratify by June 30th, 1982, we can go backwards and have serious losses and more than losses, I think. We risk never having a chance in this century of closing the wage gap between men and women. And as you know, women now make 59% of what men make in wages. But in addition to that, there are programs such as Social Security where we make half as much as what men make. And right now, the cuts in Social Security, and we're going to remind people of that, will make it such that elderly women will have to choose between fuel and food.
Ms. Mill, for 4 years, you've needed these three states. In the last 4 years, there have been no states ratifying the Equal Rights Amendment. Do you not see that possibly as an indication that the people in those states don't want the Equal Rights Amendment?
Well, the oddest thing about this whole campaign is how popular we are in the polls and in support. See, the reason we know by polling that we are popular in the unratified states, right now we have 2-to-1 support. The reason we're having trouble is the process. We have to pass two houses, the Senate and the House of these state legislatures. Just a handful of men, literally, are blocking passages. We estimate anywhere from 6 to 12 men are blocking passage in three states. And it, the total 6 to 12 men. It is a very difficult process. If women and men could go to the polls and vote for it, and if they had information about the amendment, it's even difficult to get the words out. The opposition have so distorted and lied about the amendment. We would have no trouble, but we know we're in a difficult political climate, and we know on social issues that the right wing thinks that they have a social mandate. They don't have a mandate. And we have to build a political movement in a climate that we know is hostile, except for one thing. Women are with us. And the most recent polls show that women are now going to vote. If the elections were today, they would vote by a 10% margin for Democrats because they realize that the Republican Party is holding back this amendment.
With all this support that you say, what went wrong? There was a time when it seemed like ERA was in.
Well, it's the process. We have two-thirds of it, it's approximately 72% of the population has voted for it. It's been passed in 35 states. I think the major thing, incidentally, was overconfidence. People keep thinking that it will happen. It's the 1970s, late 70s, 80s. Of course people are for women's rights. Everybody keeps saying they're for women's rights. It's just a matter of time. And in the meantime, the states that remained were in the Deep South primarily. They were controlled, or they had a very conservative blocks that could block the amendment either in a committee or in one particular house. And people didn't understand the process. It was interpreted that, and it has been interpreted that women didn't want it, which is not true. The women's vote in support has been very solid. And so it bogged down. We feel that with people realizing that there is just 12 months left, that it will give a great deal of impetus, plus the backlash to really very right-wing proposals for women. There is no question that women are going out to work, that they need equal pay, and that they want it, and that that there's a real fear that we will go backwards. We think there will be a surge forward. Political strength in the movement.
You talk about this right-wing backlash. How do you think it is that the moral majority has gotten so much political clout if there aren't, in fact, millions of Americans out there who do support it?
You know, politics is not just people being, it's not a simple process of turning people into power. They have tremendous money behind them. Tremendous mechanisms of reaching the population through the power of money. We've had numbers, we have not had the financial resources, but of course this is not to be surprised because people do profit from underpaying women. So it's been an uphill battle. Our biggest strength is that we are meeting and answering a need. There's no question women can't get along on half pay and half Social Security benefits.
Bottom line now, how optimistic are you? How realistic is it to think that you're going to get these three states?
I believe that it's uphill, but I also believe that women aren't going to go backwards. And in the final analysis, we will have the streets filled with people pushing forward for the amendment. There will be rallies, incidentally, on June 30th in 180 cities. It isn't a dead issue. It's very alive. I think it's going to be like the Italian vote on abortion. In the final analysis, women will be heard.
Thank you, Ms. Mill. We'll be right back.
Open your heart and share in the joy of helping. At Misericordia Homes, we help mentally and physically disabled children. The special needs of these children are many, but often forgotten. The love they have to offer makes their needs seem so few. Support Misericordia Homes. Call 254-9595.
Brand name quality furniture at factory cost prices. You buy just like a dealer at Weekend Warehouse Clearance Center, 2750 West 35th Street, Chicago.
Quarter.
$5.
Francis Kitty Kingdom. Let's go!
A quarter mile north of Oak Brook Center.
Every day at 4:30, there's something on TV that nobody wants to miss.
Must be 4:30.
It's called 4:30, the Eyewitness News Magazine.
You may kiss the bride.
And it's a new kind of program with an interesting difference.
Must be 4:30.
So if everyone's rushing off to see something new every afternoon...
Must be 4:30.
Watch 4:30, today at 4:30, on Channel 7.
Schaumburg Toyota says, pardon our dust. The Midwest's largest Toyota dealer is knocking down walls to expand. Now, to make up for the mess, Schaumburg Toyota is making deals. While the roof goes up, savings go sky high. While the plumbing goes in, prices go down the drain on brand new 81 Cressidas, Celicas, Corollas, Supras, Starlets, and Tercels. Don't miss Schaumburg Toyota's expansion sale. But watch your step. You might just fall for our lowest Toyota prices ever. 875 Gulf Road in Schaumburg!
And now, the Morning Eyewitness News, sponsored by Unity Savings and Loan. Here's Bob Penn.
Good morning. It's 8:25. Our downtown temperature at Chicago's lakefront, 67 degrees. Our weather for the day, it's going to be mostly sunny, breezy, and mild. High temperatures in the 80s. In the news, apparently we won't be facing the police strike threat anytime soon here in Chicago. For the first time in the city's history, a labor contract has been agreed upon for some 10,000 Chicago police officers. Details of that agreement expected to be announced in the mayor's office this morning. We've been told that Chicago's police will receive a substantial pay raise. Multimillionaire builder and developer Paul Butler struck and killed by a car last night near his northwest suburban Oak Brook home. The Butler Golf Course, named after the developer, will host the annual Western Open Golf Tournament next week. Butler was 89 years old, and police say that he was taking pictures when he was struck by the car. The driver of the car, 27-year-old James Braw, suffered some cuts and bruises on his arms. He has not been charged in connection with that accident. In other news, Governor Thompson says the state of Illinois is going bankrupt in about 2 years. We're going bankrupt, that is, unless a statewide 1 cent sales tax is agreed upon. The governor says it'll be a very difficult fight in the state legislature before that tax increase will be approved by the state legislature. State lawmakers are going to join next Tuesday. Mayor Byrne agrees to support the governor's sales and liquor tax bills for a transit bailout, but she wants more of that money designated for Chicago area mass transportation. Nevertheless, the mayor is still expected to seek city council approval today for her plans to take over the Chicago Transit Authority should city public transit face a shutdown. Mayor did announce some very good news. She says that A&M International, that's the leading supplier of equipment for graphs and information process, is moving its headquarters from Los Angeles here to Chicago. The corporation has annual sales of about $1 billion per year, and the move is expected to create hundreds of jobs here in Chicago. Mayor also said that more than 57,000 jobs have been added to the city's private sector between 1977 and 1980, the largest gains being shown in the construction industry. We'll take a look at more Chicago area news after this.
Ever see so many S&H green stamps? Must be millions of them. Unity Savings is giving them free for qualifying deposits of $300 or more. Choose from over 1,800 gifts and get your choice instantly or delivered free to your home. Open a high-interest Unity 6-month CD and get 7 full books of stamps. Keep saving at Unity and your stamps keep accumulating and suddenly, wow, you got a lot of stamps.
More federal bomb experts on their way to Chicago this morning to investigate an explosion which caused the death of a Hinsdale businessman. He's identified as Michael Cagnoni. Cagnoni driving a Mercedes on the ramp leading to the southbound tri-state tollway from Ogden Avenue when that bomb went off. It was a radio-controlled bomb. The bomb believed to have been set off from a nearby parked car that was parked in a parking lot. That bomb was believed to have been placed under the driver's seat. Bond for 22-year-old Timothy Mabe has been set at $1 million. Timothy Mabe has been accused of several rapes and robberies in the near North Side motels. Circuit court judge set the high bond after a grand jury indicted Mabe on 13 charges in addition to rape. He's also charged with armed robbery, armed violence, unlawful restraint, burglary, and a number of other offenses as well. Grand jury probing illegal dumping of hazardous waste along the DuPage River. Ty Fainter, Illinois' attorney general, has issued 22 subpoenas to companies and individuals believed to be connected with that illegal dumping. In sports, Chicago Bull basketball coach Jerry Sloan should be a happy man this morning. He signed a 3-year contract to continue coaching the Bulls. And University of Illinois football quarterback Dave Wilson says he won't play for the Fighting Illini. He's going to turn pro. Our weather again, mostly sunny, breezy, and mild. Temperatures in the 80s. Mary Ann Childress is here. Good morning, Mary Ann. Who's on AM Chicago with you today?
Coming up this morning, Bob, we're going to talk with a top American pollster about some trends he predicts could change the way we all live. Plus, Chicago Bears Ted Albrecht and Roland Harper. That's coming up at 9 o'clock. Now back to Good Morning America.
Dominic's has pot roast on sale. Makes a meal to please the heartiest appetite. And pot roast is just 87 cents a pound through Wednesday at Dominic's.
Presenting the 31 ice cream flavors. Available now at your neighborhood Baskin-Robbins.
Bay Furniture is having a $2 million store wide anniversary sale now with savings of 28 to 71%. Shop early and save. Bay Furniture in Homewood and Lincolnwood. Sale ends June 28th.
This portion of Good Morning America is brought to you by Maxwell House Instant Coffee. Every Maxwell House coffee, good to the last drop.
Good morning. David Hartman is off. I'm John Forsythe with Joan Lunden. In a few minutes, we're going to find out why so many people are practically addicted to watching soap operas. We'll talk with a psychoanalyst who has some thoughts on the subject. And also with Melody Thomas, who plays Nikki Reed on The Young and the Restless.
Nikki Reed could stand to talk to the psychoanalyst. Also, we are going to visit a town here in New York State where the people are literally afraid to drink the water, and no one is really sure how to deal with the problem. Right now, though, it's 8:30. Steve Bell has the news for us. Good morning again, Steve.
And good morning, Joan. Good morning, everyone. Yesterday, a majority of members in both the Senate and the House urged President Reagan not to sell sophisticated radar planes to Saudi Arabia. But despite the warning signs, the administration says it's going ahead with the deal and confident that minds can be changed. Jack Smith has more on the controversy.
The planes the Saudis would get are supposed to be stripped down, lacking the secret communications gear to control air battles, and so unable to threaten Israel offensively. According to the administration, the AWACS could spot an Israeli surprise attack, but little else. However, sources on Capitol Hill claim the administration's sales job has been poor, and clearly it has not worked, since a majority of 54 senators has now sent the president a letter urging him not to submit the AWACS sale because they'll vote against it, and opponents in the House claim they have a majority as well.
They are very reluctant to place these sophisticated planes that nobody else in the world has or has yet even come close to duplicating in the hands of a government that might fall, that might be taken over by radical elements, or that would turn them over to the Soviet Union.
But over at the State Department, spokesman said the administration would still submit the package, and they still thought it would pass.
The administration views the sale of the AWACS as being important to U.S. national interests, and that we are confident that when we present the full package to Congress, it will be better understood.
Better understood, but maybe still unacceptable. Nevertheless, the friendship of Saudi Arabia is thought so important, the Reagan administration appears ready to risk its first foreign policy defeat to keep it. Jack Smith, ABC News, the State Department.
In other news this morning, President Reagan's urging his allies in the House to reject a Rules Committee decision that would prevent his budget cuts from being voted on as a package. And that's expected to set up a rules fight on the House floor today. Democrats want the Reagan administration budget cuts voted on separately because they think that would make it harder for them to be approved. In Los Angeles, two small planes collided over a shopping center last night, one of them crashing on the roof of a crowded department store. The plane's pilot and two people believed to be passengers were killed. And triplet baby boys are in good condition in Baltimore this morning, in part because of a new drug. George Bauman of Baltimore station WJZ has the story.
They were born Tuesday, delivered by a cesarean section, 32-week babies, about 4 or 5 weeks shy of normal gestation. But their mother was in active labor when she was rushed here from a Washington hospital 5 weeks ago. She was on the rim of delivering her babies at 27 weeks. She'd have lost at least two, say the doctors. They'd have weighed only about 2 pounds. Delay of their delivery for 5 weeks was achieved with the use of a new anti-labor drug called Ritodrin, approved by the FDA only last September. The premature delivery-preventing drug allowed the babies to gain 2 pounds before delivery, a healthy margin. Their mother, 22-year-old Anna Brooks, whose husband is a bricklayer, was a little weak, but otherwise feeling just fine.
I'm glad it's all over with. I mean, I'm just glad it's all over with. That's all. I'm happy, too.
Brittle drip quite likely saved the lives of at least two of the triplets, and all three will be going home in a week or two. George Bauman for ABC News, Baltimore.
And that's our look at the news this morning. Joan?
Thank you, Steve. I'm John.
Sorry about that, John.
It's 8:34, and it's time for John Coleman to tell us all about the weather. What is it, John?
I'm John, too. And the weather is very messy. John, thank you. Hello, everybody. The weather report sponsored by Johnson & Johnson Reach Toothbrush. From space, we've just picked this picture up direct. What does it show? It shows the storms moving into the northeast. The Atlantic City radar confirms same. See the storms along the coast and out over Long Island? They're dissipating for the moment. More will be along. See the radar at Columbus. Look at the big storms moving through Ohio into Pennsylvania, West Virginia. Warnings have been issued. The biggest storms, however, are right along the Missouri-Kansas line, and the radar at Kansas City shows them producing flooding in several counties there as they spread into Missouri as well. And in the Gulf, we're expecting these thunder showers to continue coming ashore all along the coast today. Guess what? We have some thunder showers in Northern California. There they are on the satellite picture. They'll be spreading across Nevada into northern Utah, southern Idaho. And a scattering of thunder showers in southern Arizona today and continuing in New Mexico. Now, can you pick out your town on the weather map? Go ahead, pick it out. Because then you'll watch through the day and you'll see what we're forecasting for your town. Those little green smudges, those are the showers, thunder showers, and thunderstorms. And along that cold front in the northeast, they'll be big and mean with possible tornadoes, hail, and damaging winds today. So watch for watches and warnings to be issued. Highs in the 90s clear up into interior Oregon and Washington today. How about that? That's the national weather. Now, the local forecast.
In Chicago, real winter, mostly sunny, breezy, and mild, a high near 80. Tonight, fair, a low in the 50s. Tomorrow, sunny and pleasant, a high in the 70s. The temperatures at this time, Lakefront 68 and O'Hare 70 degrees.
Headed for the beach to play with the fish over the weekend? Well, we'll have our weekend outlook tomorrow morning. We'll see you then. Later this half hour of Good Morning America, Joan continues our series on the women you love to hate, with stars from Young and Restless.
Getting used to the Reach toothbrush might be tough, but in the fight against cavities, think of it as an unconventional weapon. The compact head is designed to clean each tooth. Bi-level bristles get between teeth and gums. The angle, like a dental instrument, reaches back teeth. Reach might be a little tough at first, but why not be armed to the teeth? Reach from Johnson & Johnson, the unconventional weapon in the fight against cavities.
It's 8:36. Recently, David got some information on a serious medical problem from Dr. Tim Johnson.
It may surprise you to know that human bites can be a serious health problem, far more serious than dog bites, for example. And Dr. Tim Johnson is with us to tell us how we should treat them. Good morning.
Good morning.
That sounds strange, but how do they happen and when do they happen?
Well, I'm not sure how all human bites happen. Sometimes in the course of just horsing around, the ones we worry most about are those bites that happen somewhat accidentally through a blow. Call a Saturday night special, I guess. Somebody slugs somebody and catches their knuckles on the teeth. And when we get a human bite, particularly in the hand, we worry because the human mouth contains germs that are very difficult for the human body to handle. And when it occurs in the hand, it's particularly dangerous because the hand is a place where infection can spread very rapidly in the spaces of the hand. And when you get an infection in the hand, you got a real problem because the hand is so critically important to our function, obviously. So that's the combination we really worry about, a bite on the knuckles from a blow to the face.
Okay. Well, what's done about it? What can be done about
it?
Well, how serious is it, really?
I consider it to be an absolute medical emergency. Anybody who gets bit accidentally or intentionally by a human bite should go to the hospital or to their doctor immediately. That wound has got to be cleaned extraordinarily carefully. Maybe open surgically, in fact, to provide adequate cleaning out. Very often, preventive or prophylactic antibiotics must be started, and there must be careful checkup for any initial sign of infection. Human bite is a medical emergency. I don't know how else to put it.
Is there anything that we can do at home, for instance, if, you know, for children or something, if you get, can you pour anything in there? Or?
Well, obviously, washing it as much as you can with soap and water is the thing to do. And then, as I say, in all but the most casual kinds of bites, have your physician check. And again, particularly if the bite occurs on the hand, that's the place that we seem to worry most about because of the rapid spread of infection that can occur.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Johnson.
Okay, David.
We'll be back in a minute.
Morning seems to start out better. You seem to go much better.
Coffee?
We start the day together. Maxwell House and you.
Coffee ready?
Get that girl to the last of feeling. With Maxwell House, only Maxwell House can do good. To the last of feeling.
I'm
sure you can take it right.
Before you open that soda pop, stop. Think about Kool-Aid.
Kool-Aid?
With those fun, fruity flavors kids love.
Yeah!
For about half the price of soda.
Half the price?
Right. And Kool-Aid has vitamin C.
Soda doesn't.
So not only do kids love to drink Kool-Aid...
Moms love to serve it.
Right. If the question is Kool-Aid or soda...
Make Kool-Aid.
Yeah! Make the smart choice. Make Kool-Aid brand soft drink mix.
It's really great to look your best.
More beautiful each day.
With silky, sexy,
shiny hair.
The Vidal Sassoon way.
Make Vidal Sassoon shampoo part of your daily three-step plan for beautiful hair.
Cause if you don't look good, we don't look good. We take pride in you. If you don't look good, we don't look good. Vidal Sassoon.
Help! Does anyone have a breath mint?
Oh.
Here you go.
Wait, try Breath Savers. They keep your breath fresh a long time.
So do mine.
Oh, but Breath Savers taste so cool and minty.
So do mine.
But Breath Savers are sugar-free.
Sugar-free?
Mm-hmm. Try one.
Breath Savers are the sugar-free way to get long-lasting breath protection, bursting all over with a minty cool breath freshener.
I like Breath Savers mints because they freshen your breath without sugar.
If you get one for the...
Best, ma'am.
It's 19 minutes before 9. Pollution of our drinking water by chemicals can happen, well, just about anywhere. And Steve Fox took a look at a community recently where people live in fear of what comes out of their taps.
Lake Carmel, about an hour and a half drive north of New York City, a former summer resort town built around a man-made lake. Lake Carmel is now the full-time home of blue-collar and middle-class workers and their families. This community is similar to just about every other small town in America, except for one thing. Many of the people who live in Lake Carmel are afraid of their water. Imagine what it's like to live in fear of something as basic and as essential as the water in your home.
They spend so much time today, you know, trying to tell us how to live in healthy ways, how to be careful about things, and they educate us. And then you find out that the simplest thing in the world is poisoning you, your tap water.
If we have this much contamination now in the water, and God knows how long it's been in my water, what are going to be the effects on our children?
You know, and as far as medical data, at this point in time, there isn't any. We're all a bunch of guinea pigs.
It's a horrible feeling to live with, that you can't walk into your own kitchen and run a glass of water when you've done it all your life.
Most people in Lake Carmel get their water from an underground reservoir tapped by artesian wells. But some folks have been told by health officials not to drink the water. Others, worried, refuse to drink it and only reluctantly use it for bathing and dishwashing. Contaminants known to cause cancer were discovered in some wells a year and a half ago. Chemical compounds from a still unlocated oil or gas spill. Nowadays, many people buy expensive bottled water or they go daily to a clear spring nearby.
They're terrified to drink the water. They're very, very upset. Every time you talk to someone, they ask you, how's your water? Now, if that's the topic on the tongues of everyone in this town, I'd say that's a little paranoia running around.
In the middle of 1979, the family that lives in this house began complaining to the state that they were tasting and smelling oil in their water. State came out, tested the well, found contamination. And a couple of months later, two neighbors down the hill did the same thing, complained about oil in the water. The state did more tests, found more contamination. Three tests, three bad wells. But still, the state waited seven more months before it did any tests on the other homes in the neighborhood. Why?
Nobody else complained of it. Okay. If you start testing, you know, people's wells on speculation that there might be chemicals, you'll have to test every well in New York State.
As I understand it, you had three complaints in one specific area. You checked out all three complaints, and all three were found to be contaminated. The wells, the water was bad. Why did you not then immediately start checking the wells of the homes around those three?
From our experience, if there's no complaints, then there has not been problems.
Because the contamination probably came from a petroleum product, the State Department of Transportation is in charge of ongoing tests, which seem to show that the petrochemicals have completely disappeared from local wells. Worried residents don't believe those tests, pointing out that 4 months ago, different tests turned up more than 30 highly contaminated wells.
Throughout, state officials have maintained that the contaminated area is small and isolated, that they may never be able to find the original source of contamination, and that there's no way to directly link the reported medical problems with bad water.
One of the reported medical problems involved this boy, Michael Olafiers, who once had all the painful symptoms of juvenile arthritis, even though specialists said he didn't have the disease. The symptoms have disappeared since he stopped drinking the water. Other residents blame the water for strange rashes, raspy voices, and greater susceptibility to common colds, while admitting that they may be exaggerating the problem because of their fear.
For the individual, the fear, I think, is more of a risk than the individual exposure. For the nation as a whole, obviously we want to cut down on these type of exposures because those numbers start adding up.
Dr. Bernard Goldstein of Rutgers University is an expert on groundwater pollution. We caught up with him before a flight to Washington, D.C., where he was lecturing about the problem. The professor contends that worrying about low levels of hydrocarbon poisoning may actually be more harmful than the pollution itself.
The risk is such that it's not worth being fearful about it, but it sure as hell is worth going banging on some doors and getting the thing cleaned up. It's coming from somewhere. I mean, that stuff wasn't there when they dug those wells. And I would be looking real hard to find out where it's from. But I would be doing something rather than being concerned. I don't think there's a reasonable grounds for concern about this type of exposure to the extent that it cripples you, that it makes you fearful, that it makes you get up at night, that it gives you sufficient stress that you have to start worrying about exacerbating a heart attack or your kid not being able to study. Or just no reason for that. The risk is not great.
They're going to ask us to continue to drink this water, maybe until something dire really does happen, until some child comes up with leukemia, until somebody dies, until somebody loses a kidney. And to me, that's unacceptable. I don't want to live that way. I don't want to live drinking things that I don't know what's in it.
Steve, what is the bottom line here? I mean, it seems like such a frustrating problem.
Well, that's exactly it, Joan. It's frustrating for everybody concerned, for the government, which really is trying to do everything that they know how to do to fix it, but they admit they're learning on the job, for the experts who can't tell people for sure that they will be all right, that there is no problem, and for the people themselves who are going to have to continue to live for years with this fear of the unknown, of what's in their water.
It's really scary. Oh. Thank you. We're going to be back in just a moment. We're going to be talking with Melody Thomas from The Young and the Restless. Stay with us.
You won't find them in a Sealy. You won't find them in a Serta. You won't find them in a Stearns and Foster, but you will find them in a Beauty Rest by Simmons. Hundreds of these exclusive Beauty Rest coils. They're wrapped individually so they're free to move separately to give every part of your body the kind of firm, comfortable support you won't find anywhere but here.
There's just no rest like a Beauty Rest by Simmons.
every day all over America, it's the Battle of the Burgers.
Hey, everybody's leaving.
You need a burger you can brag about. Add Lipton onion soup mix.
Onion soup? Why not just add onions?
Lipton adds more. It has a special blend of seasonings and toasted onion pieces that turn hamburgers into...
Mmm, a super onion burger. Hey, here's a burger you can brag about.
Win the Battle of the Burgers. Soup up your burgers with Lipton.
More people, more construction, more industry, more problems.
It all adds up to more news in Chicago's Northwest area, and that's why Eyewitness News has a bureau here. I'm Kim Peterson. I work out of a fully staffed base of operations here in Rosemont. It means I'll be at the scene of fast-breaking news in the Northwest area, while other stations may still be trying to get out of downtown. Channel 7 is the only Chicago TV station with a Northwest bureau. That's why, now more than ever, 7's on your side.
I give you the world's first free-form Frank.
Why, Ralph?
Creative cooking, George. Look, Eckrich quality.
Mom says Eckrich already spells quality, like plump, juicy Franks with selected cuts of meat and no cereal fillers.
But now folks can see the Eckrich difference.
Ralph, make sure they taste the difference.
But Mom...
Ralph.
Eckrich means good meat from the heartland, and the secret ingredient is Mom.
And things were just taking shape.
Behave, Ralph.
Ten before nine, all this week we have been talking with the so-called women we love to hate, the actresses who take on the roles of those nasty, vicious, selfish, manipulative characters on the afternoon soap operas. Today we are going to be talking with Dr. Harvey Greenberg, a psychoanalyst who has some thoughts on why these women attract us so much. Also with one more woman who fits that type, Melody Thomas. She plays Nikki Reed, another nasty, vicious person on The Young and the Restless. Good morning to both of you. Why don't we start, Melody, by having you explain just a little bit about your character for those who don't follow the soap.
Okay. Nikki is... very fun-loving gal who at the moment is stripping, believing that she will be a star, you know, that she's going to get to Vegas and then who knows what. So she's doing that and right now is being tormented by a secret admirer who's calling and sending gifts and
she's been through an incredible amount of problems,
yeah,
though, over the years. I would say that she is someone who needs to go see the doctor. What about this character?
Well, I don't see Nikki as a villainess or a bad person. She is more of the kind of person who attracts trouble like a lightning rod. She has a lot of zest, a lot of joy, but she keeps stumbling into these situations, and people get drawn into her problems like a whirlpool, and suddenly everything is very, very messy. She suffers, she gets involved, somehow she survives, leaving a lot of wreckage behind her.
Yes.
And well, Melody, you've said many times you thought she was the victim rather than...
Yes,
you know,
that's what they said, you know, you're going to be doing this show as a woman you love to hate. And I thought, I'm not mean, I'm not a bad person, really, because everything that happens just kind of happened. It wasn't my fault, you know?
Well, of course, many real-life Nickies have that same feeling. It's not that they're bad people, but somehow people get involved with them and they provoke all kinds of things without being aware of it.
Why do we need these people? Because, I mean, everybody's watching these soaps. Why is it that we seem to need these characters?
Well, I think they have many of our problems only raised to the nth degree.
Yeah.
Our suffering, we can turn off the plug on them. We can turn off the TV, and then it's over for us, but somehow there's a kind of awful comfort in knowing that they're always there going on and on. Also, like a lightning rod, these situations, the soaps, show us a lot of common problems around us, things that the media is talking about. Yesterday, somebody on Young and the Restless was trying to find out their adopted sister, I believe. Mm-hmm. And right now, there's a big preoccupation with adoption, and how do you get back to the people that you came from?
Well, do they serve a purpose? I mean, even for letting us kind of, you know, get it out emotionally,
yeah,
by
big
watching
catharsis. There are hammers.
You think it's a healthy thing, then?
Sure. Sure, I think it's kind of cheap therapy for a lot of people.
It's great therapy for us.
But do you ever worry, though, that what you're doing on the show might you know, allow somebody at home to be sitting thinking, gee, you know, I can do that too, that they might start actually to live out their own fantasies instead of just watching it.
Well, I don't think so. Not with my character, I don't think they would be
able
to do that. It could be. You're the expert.
I think people look at Nikki and say, my God, I can't be that bad. I'll never get involved in that. My problems are just a pale shadow.
Maybe they'll
learn
a few things.
Yeah, they can objectify themselves. I don't think people are spurred to act out any more than watching Hamlet.
No.
Do you think that the soaps have a particular interest to women who might feel that they are themselves trapped, maybe in their own little soap opera?
For sure. I think that we would like to think that women are liberated today, but many women, many people in general, find themselves stuck and unable to get out. And there's a kind of, I think, identification with somebody who is always stuck. Somehow I think you can get free of your own problems for a minute or two and say, well, gee, I may be stuck, but I'm not glued down.
They're more worse off than I am.
And on the other side of that, she's a wonderful survivor. She goes on. She goes on from cult membership.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I can somehow get through with it. I can get to the other side of it. And she's got a lot of juice.
Cult and murders and attempted rape by my father, who I hit over the head with a lamp and he died. But it was self-defense.
See, now there's...
I mean, I did not maliciously try and kill my father.
What kind of mail do you get? I mean, I wonder if you actually see what we're talking about and what people
I
say.
I get wonderful mail. I've never gotten any hate mail or anything. A lot of people, it's hard because it's on a soap. It's hard for people to separate Melody, Nikki. If I'm on the street, it's Nikki. And people will write in, you know, different organizations, we can help you, you know, they send me pamphlets and
they
things.
They forget that
oh, yeah,
not a real
well,
person.
They start out the letter. Now, we realize that you are not Nikki, that you're just an actress playing her, but I think we could be very beneficial to you soon.
What's it like for you to be involved day after day after day after
it,
day?
It at times becomes very real. There was a period a couple years ago where Nikki and Greg were going through some very bad times, and that was my husband at the time on the show. It was so traumatic day after day for weeks. It was in the process of breaking up our marriage and crying and agony. And we started taking that home. We would both go home and have nightmares. We'd be dreaming, screaming. We'd wake up and say, oh, God, Greg, Nikki.
Oh, boy. You have to call up the doctor.
She never learns. It's like somebody said about the Bourbon Kings. They remembered everything and they learned nothing.
Well, it sounds to me like you think it's something that's really healthy besides just being an enjoyable story to watch. So thank you both for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll be back tomorrow. We're going to be talking with Robin Strasser from One Life to Live.
I got my A's.
I got my B's.
We've got our E's.
Got my C and D.
I get Myodec because I want more for me.
Myodec, 11 vitamins and 6 minerals. More potency than the other leading multivitamins with minerals.
I got my manganese, magnesium, my copper, and my zinc.
My niacin and iodine.
Iron. I get Myodec because I want more for me.
From Park Davis.
See all these steaks? Well, your dog can get the meat protein of every one of them in this bag of Alpo Beef Flavored Dinner. Alpo Dry is packed full of meat protein. There's no need to add meat. Now, dogs need protein, and they love the taste of beef, don't you, Bowser? So give your dog Alpo Beef Flavored Dinner, and give him the meat protein of these 10 steaks. Alpo Beef Flavored Dinner. With so much meat protein, there's never any need to add meat.
Smoke signals, Ralph.
Promotion, George. Where there's smoke, there's smoked sausage. Get it?
You'll get it from Mom. She says to promote Eckrich quality, like our juicy, delicious smoked sausage with selected cuts of meat and our own seasonings.
But now folks can see the Eckrich difference.
Ralph, make sure they taste the difference.
Eckrich means good meat from the heartland, and the secret ingredient is Mom.
Another idea up in smoke.
Behave, Ralph.
At Red Lobster, we've got a dinner we build shrimp by shrimp by beautiful shrimp. Just for starters, there's an Alaskan shrimp cocktail. Then, of course, lots of golden fried shrimp. And something maybe you didn't expect, like shrimp from the oven, stuffed with deviled crab. Oh, the shrimp lover's platter. Oh, hey, we named it after you.
Red Lobster for the sea.
Thank you.
find out about some experiments with a mini computer that someday may help people who suffer from paralysis or muscular disorders.
And of course, we're going to be winding up our series about soap opera women you love to hate.
Top of the morning to you. Have a very good day.
More young women are watching ABC daytime than CBS and NBC combined. ABC has the top-rated shows. General Hospital, All My Children, One Life to Live, Ryan's Hope, the number one daytime dramas on ABC.
Good morning. America's on the brink of a social revolution that may well shake the very foundations of our society. That's what one of America's foremost social observers and pollsters maintains. He's Daniel Yankelovic, and this morning he'll tell us just what this revolution's going to be like and how it's going to affect all of us. Also this morning, we'll talk with a couple of professional athletes who are not on strike. That's next on AM Chicago.
Every day at 4:30, there's something on TV that nobody wants to miss.
Must be 4:30.
It's called 4:30, the Eyewitness News Magazine.
You may kiss the bride.
And it's a new kind of program with an interesting difference.
Must be 4:30.
So if everyone's rushing off to see something new every afternoon...
Must be 4:30.
Watch 4:30, today at 4:30, on Channel 7.
Save at the gym.
It's Venture's White Sale. Save on three-piece Studio Lace Eyelet Twin Sheet Set, top and bottom sheet, and pillowcase, $7.99. Snap up everyone's favorite bath towel, Canon Santa Cruz, in nine colors, just $2.69. Save on Fiberfill 5 pillows with full two-year warranty in soft, medium, or firm, two for $9. Hurry for these savings and more during Venture's White Sale.
Save at Venture. Yeah, save with style.
Now, you can buy luxurious custom-made draperies direct from the Drapery Factory. Save up to 50% by calling NA25800. A Drapery Factory man will come to your home with colors, patterns, and styles that you'll think cost twice the price. Luxurious $6 antique satin, our price $3 per yard. The Drapery Factory is the new money-saving way to buy beautiful custom draperies. Call NA25800. Save up to 50%. Buy direct from the factory, the Drapery Factory. Call NA25800 for a free home estimate.
Slimy death today at 3.
Good morning. Welcome to AM Chicago. And now here's Marianne Childers.
Good morning and welcome to AM Chicago on a day that has the promise of being a beautiful day as it continues. I'm sitting in for Rob Weller this week and glad you could be with us. A little later on this morning, we're going to be talking to a couple of Chicago Bears to ask them as athletes what they think about the baseball strike, also the Bears' upcoming season. But first, our first guest is one of America's top social observers and poll takers. His map of our society's trends are seen regularly in such popular publications as Time magazines, among others, and also in his new book, which is called New Rules, Searching for Fulfillment in a World That's Turned Upside Down. Now, he's predicting that society is on the verge of a major social upheaval, one that's going to change forever the way we live, our lives, our families, our jobs, and the choices we make for ourselves. His name is Daniel Yankelovic. Pardon me, Yankelovic.
That's right.
Thank
that's
you.
Right.
Yeah, welcome,
right,
and thanks right, for coming. A world turned upside down. I'm wondering how long you have been measuring trends, the way we think and the way we feel, and what's happening to get us in this situation?
Well, a couple of things are happening. One thing that's happened in the world turned upside down is that we live for 30 years with a growing economy, with affluence. I mean, that the period after World War II up to the late 70s was the period of greatest growth the world's ever known. And then suddenly we find ourselves in a stagnant economy with diminishing means. So that's one big change. We find the country has competitors in the world, Japanese, Germans, other countries, it's never had before. So you have an economic crunch on the one hand. And on the other hand, you've had a period where people have gotten used to the idea that life doesn't have to be a grim economic chore. They've come to value the kinds of choices that they have in their lives. And all of a sudden, that is threatened by this change in the economy. So when I grew up in a world with a very rigid set of rules about living and a booming economy, and now we have a very loose culture and a
very restrictive
economy. So it is a world turned upside down in that way.
We got kind of comfortable, didn't we, in the 50s because things were absolute and maybe for that reason simple. I mean, we knew the rules. We knew who was in charge and what we had to do.
Oh, yes. The rules were very, very clear cut and taken for granted. I started interviewing people in that period, and I remember one of my first interviews, I asked a woman why she wanted to be married and have children. And she looked at me almost unbelievingly that I would ask such a question and said, you know, why do you put your pants on in the morning? You know, it's an option. There was no option. That was the way it was. And people just took it for granted and followed that kind of very set commitment.
And there was a strong work, that we hear about the work ethic. There were certain principles that we believed in and we had to follow, or we felt we did.
Well, people felt that they had to sacrifice. Women to sacrifice for their family, men to sacrifice for their family by working, and no matter how unpleasant the work may have been, if you made a good living, and you could take care of your family, then it was all worthwhile. You were a real man, you were a good provider.
Now, we don't want to make that seem negative. There are people today that maybe they didn't do what they wanted, but they're proud.
Well, it isn't negative at all. I think one of the things people are struggling with now is making choices that are traditional choices and feeling good about themselves for doing so. The other day, this lovely person I work with in the publisher's office said to me that at the elevator, a colleague of hers who was pregnant was about to leave to have her baby, and she said to her, "When will you be coming back?" And her friend looked and said, "Well, I'm not coming back." And my friend was startled because she assumed that this woman was obviously going to come back to work
in
this glamorous.
That's been the trend.
Publishing house, and she also realized that in a sense, she was making this very traditional choice